Hello, I'm Henry Mack. Last month, the founder of Liberation Theology, the Reverend Gustavo Gutierrez, received a warm welcome at the Vatican. The once condemned religious movement from Latin America is experiencing somewhat of a resurgence under Pope Francis, the first pope to come out of the region. The Vatican newspaper says that Liberation Theology can no longer, quote, remain in the shadows to which it has been relegated for some years, end quote. What is Liberation Theology, and will this movement gain more support in the coming years? Joining me to discuss, Ana Maria Bindegain, Professor of Religious Studies at Florida International University, and Elsie Miranda, Associate Professor of Practical Theology at Barry University. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
This is a really exciting topic, one that is misunderstood, and I'm happy that we have the opportunity now, especially in light of Pope Francis, to discuss it anew. Liberation theology, first question, what is it? So if we can provide maybe a general definition of what it is, and then move to discuss the political importance for this sort of revisiting. I was wondering if you can feel that, Ana Maria.
Well, liberation theology is a reflection on the experience of Christian living the experience of God. Liberation theology is theology as any other. But coming from Latin America, we need to put a subtitle. Was theology. And is the theology made from the perspective of the Second Vatican II? It's totally immersed in that. And I think that came also from the experience of some Christian women and men, as Gustavo Gutierrez in his first book said, and particularly from the Catholic Action Movement and organization that were very active in the 60s and 70s in Latin America. And then it's a systematization of this experience. And I think that there is the misconception that you said, because sometime they made in a whole many things together. The reflection, that is the theology, as a intellectual process, but at the same time, all the movement that is behind, and also the pastoral work. And sometimes they do a confusion on all these things. Are related, but are not the same. And that's happened with the liberation theology. I think that perhaps the most important is the new method, that liberation theology is starting by dialoguing with the reality. Before, theology used to dialogue with science, but particularly with philosophies, and they part from the hair, well, I'm sorry, from abstraction. But in the case of liberation theology and the new view that bring the Second Vatican II was more related to analyze the reality.
So classically, theology is defined the study of God, the contemplation of God, in light of the revealed truths that God has provided to humankind via primarily scripture and tradition. But liberation theology begins with a reflection about God first through analysis of what confronts us politically, economically,
historically.
It begins by interpreting or seeing the gospel in light of what is affecting mankind, humankind.
And a simplified way of naming that is that liberation theology is going to begin with context, and it's going to bring scripture and tradition and dialogue to the contextual reality of a community, a society, etc. And so in the wake of Vatican II, what happens is that the theologians in Latin America had to do a theological reflection, an examination of how scripture and tradition was in fact calling the contextual phenomenon of the human condition into a liberative paradigm. And that's where Marxist philosophy as a methodology, as a way of critiquing the social political phenomenon of the time, was used not to promote a new political regime, which is where the misunderstandings began with the Vatican, but to really critique how we could be Catholic, how could we be Christian and not have a preferential option for the poor, which is indeed what the gospel was and has always been calling us to.
So what was going on in Latin America that caused this shift in perspective, theologically speaking? If you can take a step back to the phrase that you described liberation theology with, inviting us to look at the context, the phenomenon that we encounter, the paradigms that face us. Why was it in Latin America, and what prompted this revisiting of the gospel?
Well, it was after the Second World War. The economical condition was very, very hard, particularly for the majority of the people. But at the same time, the political system, even if they, in some cases there were some dictatorships, but mm-hmm. it depends on the countries, but in other cases, even if they have election don't mean democracy. Democracy is something much more important and more deeper. And then in this way, I think that what happened is that the people was looking for a real participation, for a real citizenship. Mm-hmm. And then I think that in the contrary, I feel that if the liberation movement that is larger than liberation theology will be able to continue their path, we will have a much more democratic countries today than we have now. Mm-hmm. And perhaps we need to explain how it's come, how it work. Is normally they work in small communities, as I said, first were small communities of workers or students, because the Catholic action, for example, from where Lula bring is from the working class organization, they started reflecting on some particular issues, particular problem that the community is living. Mm-hmm. In many cases, it's a social problem, maybe a political problem, maybe economic as well. Any problem that is important for the community and impact the rest. And then they try to analyze it. Then analyzing it, they use all the tools that they have, sociological, anthropological, historical, all that they need. And it's in this moment that Marxism is used as an epistemological tool.
But Marxism.
But no more.
Right.
But no more. It has a value to understand the society because, for example, the class analysis may help to understand the social reality, but don't mean that allow to bring to have the first look on the reality. And secondly, they bring, as he said, the reading of the scriptures, what the tradition, the teaching of the church, what the gospel tell us. Mm-hmm. And then in a third moment, how we will act. Then that is the method of
right.
the communities and the method of liberation theology, that dialogue with the reality.
Mm-hmm. So we are, liberation theology then is a school of thought. It is a dialoguing with what confronts us. It is exploring the relationship between Christian theology and political activism. It is trying in every way to sort of unite the two.
But not necessarily political. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily, it's much more than political. It's all what is related to human being, all that concern human situation. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, in this concern,
you react,
and part of the things that concern the situation of human being is political, because political take everything.
In hopes of bringing about justice.
And the center is justice.
Right.
Right.
It's how to look for justice, and how to talk about the love of God in a situation that is totally unjust. politically.
How to speak about the love of God in a situation that is totally unjust. So if you can come back to the misconception that you articulated at the beginning, mm-hmm. it seems as though the end goal is agreeable, the bringing about justice on earth, mm-hmm. The liberation from oppression, mm-hmm. From the effects of original sin. Mm-hmm. How has this then become so controversial, especially under the previous two popes, John Paul II, under whom it was, I think, officially condemned. And of course, the penman of the condemnation was the then Joseph Ratzinger, mm-hmm. who was in charge of the whole office of the faith.
Right. And I think we have to go back to John Paul II, whose experience of communist Poland informed his papacy in, you know, in incredible ways. And you know, we want to honor and give him credit for, you know, the dismantling of communism in Poland, because he did have an incredible amount of impact on the Solidarity movement. The problem is that the experience of communism in Latin America and South America was really quite different, and the systems of oppression were required a critique of political regimes. But when you said that liberation theology moves towards politics, I'm not sure if I'm quoting you exactly, but you know, Johann Baptist Metz said that you can't do theology in the wake of World War II with your back turned to Auschwitz. And that was a really important statement, because when Latin American theologians were recognizing the situation in which they were living, they realized that they couldn't do theology with their back turned to the people. And so the contextual situations, albeit social, political, educational, needed to be critiqued, and the question asked, you know, how is this community's humanity being upheld? How are we as a society promoting justice? And so you had to critique political systems, economic injustice, but not because that was your primary objective. Your primary objective was the redemption of the human person, mm-hmm. and the community. So it becomes political by default, but that's not its intention.
Right. Yeah. So then what was the problem, at least perceived by then Joseph Ratzinger?
Well, I think at some point it becomes a question of the paradigm of power. And at some level, the church under John Paul II and Joseph Ratzinger was very paternalistic, very patriarchal, and liberation theology, by its very nature, wants to empower and give voice and promote dialogue. And paternalistic, patriarchal systems aren't promoting dialogue, they're promoting obedience. And so there's a fundamental shift in how to operate ecclesiologically, mm-hmm. The way a community understands itself. And if we're promoting dialogue, somebody needs to be there to listen, and that would also require an openness to change, to critique. In the critique, you know, how do we change sometimes, you know, ancient magisterial teachings that perhaps have gone by the way of irrelevant.
Yeah. Yeah. It seems as though the issue is more of an abuse on the part of some using liberation theology as an excuse to bear arms, as an excuse to wage war in a violent way, using the gospel of Jesus Christ as a pretext for violence, mm-hmm. or as a justification political movements.
I think that there are more things. One is, of course, there were some people related to those movements who took the arms and mm-hmm. participate in the guerrillas. It's the case of, even before liberation theology, but it's the case of Camilo Torres, that is one of the most known. But there was others who but was the minority, even those. And they weren't theologians. Hmm? They were people who were engaged. That's, I say that they put all together in the same things. But that happened is in the sense of criticism. Don Elder Camara used to say, when I take care of the poor, they say that I am a saint. When mm-hmm. I ask why are they poor, then I am communism, mm-hmm. communist. Then, you know, that is what that happened. At this time, you are very young, but I can tell you, was very dangerous in the 70s. When I was in the university, it was very dangerous mm-hmm. to talk about the poor. Mm-hmm. Was very, a lot of people lost their life because they talk about the poor. And there was a lot of people who asked dialogue and they lost their life, many Christians. Mm-hmm. And then that is the problem is also that politically there was also a perception, as you have been saying, that this criticism mm-hmm. of the reality, then that's support communism. Right. And that's begun by the elite in Latin America. Last year, no, a few months ago, I went to the National Archive here in the United States. And looking on the Colombian case, I discovered that under Nixon presidency, there were one president, Gerard Restrepo, with López, that came later, and they were talking to Nixon about the communism in the church. López said, well, they are not communists, they speak like communists. And later, in the 80s, we have the documents of Santa Fe that were being to Reagan. And that is 4 years before any condemnation to liberation theology. Mm-hmm. Then and also the press began to talk once again and in another moment the same ideas mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. without looking really in the sources. And then they repeat the same slogan that the church was plenty of communist and began the repression. And even the conservative or not so many conservatives began to have to be afraid, many of the bishops. And then that began to have a lot of confusion even inside the church.
So the misconception on the part of the Vatican as a result of Pope John Paul II's insistence on liberating, oddly enough, Poland and the Solidarity Movement, his fear of further communistic entrenchment in Latin America, mm. prompted by American conservatism at the time under Reagan, mm. all of this sort of came together to label yeah. liberation theology in an unfair way.
Yeah, mm-hmm. of course.
So now that we have Pope Francis, a year into his papacy, the first pope from Latin America, someone who is obviously very much concerned with the poor, and reintroducing the notion of the preferential option for the poor, we ought to, as Christians, prefer all things for the sake of helping those in need. Mm-hmm. He is sort of bringing to light again now this topic. What do you make of this in terms of him now mm-hmm. sort of addressing the substance, mm-hmm. not just the style, but really getting at, I think, some substance here with respect to Catholic teaching?
Well, I'd like to point out also that in the 80s, there was a Brazilian Paulo Freire, historian, education leader, who was promoting the idea of conscientization. And I find that what Pope Francis is saying is really an awakening of the human consciousness of a universal church and of a global community. He's not saying, let's go, you know, give handouts to the poor. But he's really asking us all, and in his critique of capitalism, is asking us all to promote ways of doing business and of going about our business in a way that is just, in a way that gives people equal opportunities, that gives people a voice. You know, I think that what we need to be mindful of is how we give and provide access to education, how we, you know, deal with insiders and outsiders in every gamut of our social and political situations, because that's the kind of justice that the gospel was calling for. And when, for example, Gustavo Gutierrez is asking us to consider how base communities are transforming, you know, the social structure of a country, those base communities are being empowered by the by relationships. Yes. They're not getting a handout. It's not a welfare system. Sure. That is, in fact, the exact opposite of what...
And this is the principle of subsidiarity that the church very much espouses. Mm-hmm. Grassroots transformation through the people.
Right.
And some of these quotes from Pope Francis, and I'll read some. Well, Pope Francis, the thing that sparked this is he's writing an introduction or the preface to a new book by Gerhard Mueller, who is now taking the then Ratzinger's place in the Holy Office. Mm-hmm. Mueller affirms that, quote, poverty in Latin America oppresses children, the elderly, and the sick to such an extent that many are driven to contemplate death as the only way out. And liberation theology now is a movement that is forcing us to reflect, to analyze the context, and to see how the gospel can address the needs of these individuals anew, mm-hmm. in a new way, in a more just way, in a more Christ-like way. Mm-hmm. So it's not political in that sense, and perhaps the initial reaction was because it became politicized. Mm-hmm. But I think I think we would all do well to sort of revisit, I think, Gustavo Gutierrez's readings on this. Sure. Who is the founder, one of the founders of Liberation Theology, and you both studied under him, mm-hmm. which is fantastic. So it's the satisfaction we need to satisfy the needs that we are confronted with in Latin America, and we're trying to do so by bringing about the gospel again in this new light. What do you think? What parts of Latin America are, or is the Pope addressing? What parts are we concerned with here? Is this throughout, or?
I think it is throughout. I mean, we were talking earlier, the problems in Venezuela, the problems in Colombia, in...
everywhere.
South America in general is in a very tenuous situation.
It always is in a tenuous, really.
But what I find... And somewhat paradoxical is that if liberation theology and if liberation theologians were able to really promote that kind of consciousness that Freire was talking about, mm-hmm. we would end up engendering generations of people who had the capacity to have some self-determination and promote true democracy.
Yeah,
and in a way,
that's citizenship.
Right, yeah. Citizenship. And sure. That would abolish the kinds of communist hoodlums that are, you know, overpowering the poor and oppressing the poor in a completely different way. But, you know, it will take a significant amount of time because, we can't just throw money at it. We have to really engage people in relationships that are transformative.
And that's what the gospel is calling everyone to do.
Yes.
Yeah.
Final thoughts on this topic.
Well, I think that now is a new moment that we will see how it could the churches in Latin America could react, because the problem is that we need to take into account that during this 30 years, there have been a lot of repression of all this movement, and then we don't have all the organization that we used to have, or starting in the 60s and 70s, then I think that now, for example, the orders and congregation, they have suffered a lot, mm-hmm. too. And then and that has been very difficult for those congregations to grow up and right. to have more vocation, because this has a lot of weight on them. Then I hope that with the new reality, then the church can have a different presence. Have always had. In Latin America,
yeah.
But to have a different presence and the possibility to really strengthen democracy.
It's an excellent way for the church to continue to stay relevant mm-hmm. to the people that it serves by reading things in this light. And I think it's just good to bring awareness to this topic. Thank you very much for joining us. We're out of time. Mm-hmm. For today's program, I'd like to thank all of our guests for joining us. Visit our website at wpbt2.org/viewpoint and post your comments on today's program. We would love to hear your thoughts. Join us for another episode of Viewpoint Sunday, April 6th and Sunday, April 20th at 12:30 p.m. I'm Henry Mack, and thank you very much for watching.